It can be a cabinet decision, or is it sufficient, or it has to be a legislation? Quickly for 1.5 minutes.
Yeah, from the perspective of bringing a change, in this government they won't have any challenges. For a simple reason, they have the power to even amend the constitution. So when they have that kind of a power, certain institution has to be broken down through cabinet decisions. Certain institution like UGC has to go through constitutional amendments for bringing certain powers to the new institution that is going to come in. And certain institutions are about merging the administrative for bringing administrative convenience. Accordingly, from the legal angle, there are constitutional amendments which is required. And not only that, it's a policy document which the state government has to adopt. As simple as that. Because education is both a central policy as well as a state subject, as well as a central subject, the concurrent list as per the Constitution of India. And that, for that, the state government has to take a lot of efforts in bringing that without diluting the national education policy. So to ensure that has to happen, the government at the central level will bring changes to ensure that all the policies, what the national level policies comes into picture, should be implemented. For that, they'll bring a constitution amendment also if required. So at this stage, what the government is looking at is taking stakeholder inputs and bringing certain changes which are convenient to the stakeholders, because you should not complain at the end of the day, my views are not taken, majority of the views are not taken. So they want to show some kind of recommendations that is coming from you people. For that, you can respond very well. I'm sure in Chennai, not much of the institution are actually represented. If Dr. MGR Janaki College is going to do that, I think you are the first to do that before 30th. And one more month the government has given. Yesterday the HRD minister has given one more month. I think you should take it up with the large scale. This is my suggestion.
Thank you, Sathya. That is one question, and even somebody was telling me, even to join the new education policy after the plus two, whether we need to have a need even to join any joint higher education. As for the latest, that according to the report, the gross enrollment ratio after the 12th standard, it is around 25.8% as at 2017-18, which was earlier 20.8. That means only 20% of the people in 2011-12, they joined higher education. And now in 2017-18, 25 people are joining. The education policy aims at 50% of by 2035. Some people were asking whether you need a NEET examination after the plus two. One of the argument is, if only 25 people are going to join higher education, rest of the 75% are not going to join higher education, they may go for a different vacation. They may need some certification of school leaving, even in America or any other advanced state also. Now I would like to have the views of both the professors, each 1 minute. As an academician, whether it be need after the plus two?
Certainly, because we are going to answer. The question is a little bit complicated, but my perspective is we need to have such a system in the national level so that the student, then only we can bring this rural population into mainstream. Right? And this is a competitive basis. And whereas this kind of system is very vital for the country, otherwise still we'll be lacking far behind even after 20, 30 years. The change, whatever the policy you are discussing, the change is required. So there are so many changes in our lifestyle, food habit and environment, everything. But the education alone, we are having lot of resistance. I don't know why this resistance is required. And my perception is, everyone should not utilize the lack of knowledge among the rural population. I personally feel that I don't have such opportunity to study Hindi during my school time in village. I am also victim of that. So that this kind of trend should not continue. As an academician, my view is very clear that systematic change is required from time to time. But before going to implement it, we need lot of brainstorming and stakeholders meeting, getting the perception of the community from different level. These are the things required. So once you come to a common conclusion, majority of the population is expecting that this kind of change. So definitely we have to move towards this kind of change.
Thank you, Professor Gopan. See, the primary concern here, according to me, is not merely making a judgment saying that these fellows can go beyond 12, these fellows can go only up to degree. That is not being judgmental. But our social context is such that we give them a choice. The simple solution is, as the report envisages, whenever a learner wants to learn, there must be an opportunity. Therefore, where is the question that we are asking? You can learn anytime. Anywhere, anytime, learning is possible. All streams, formal, non-formal, reinforced learning, every stream will be up and running. The question here is, when is the certification going to happen and how it is going to happen? Without that, we will not be able to have an assurance check in what they are doing. And also, the fact remains that we have to build more confidence in the system through timely checks. That checkpointing is what is the crux. They can do it even now. Even now it is possible. After fifth class, they can go home and they can tell we are studying on our own. And they can appear after 3 years for a consolidated test of 3 years. In theory, yes. In practice, can we do it in large system? But the report is nice. As I observed, the report tries to blend together. Very nice report. Again, Dr. Kasturi Rangan's team must be congratulated. Formal, non-formal, learn at your pace, competency-based, recognition of prior learning, all of them are built into the report. It is a question of saying that when I say I am ready to be tested, will I be tested and certified? Then this idea of dropout also will dilute.
Another important question that for academicians. One of the senior professors of MBA of another college, he was telling me that when he is teaching, he is a senior professor, he is yet to retire. What he teaches in the MBA is the same syllabus what he learned in Madras University in those days when he was a student. Why there is a lack of, now will it be addressed in the new education policy? I think both the professors can. Are we updating the syllabus? I used to take classes for Madras University in the journalism in 90s. When the internet came, I have been telling them, so introduce 95 internet came. Even in 2000, I used to tell them journalism, internet technology has grown. You introduce internet journalism. And it took a long time for them to introduce a chapter or introduce some paper on digital or internet. Even the people who are only writing about or the journalism means the age-old type of journalism which was already gone. This type of, unless the student gets the latest syllabus or latest updated with a thing, it may not be of any use. Then they become unfit for the industry. Can I have the views of Professor Krishnamurthy and Professor Gopal?
Yeah. Within the system, what can be done the best, that can be done by the faculty, whatever may be the system. And we have working within the system, we have so many limitations. But when I am heading a department, I know what is the present challenges, the requirement for my geology student. When you want to go to that oil industry or any other industry, so what is the requirement from the industry side? Who has to work it out? If I am going to update my MSc syllabus, then no one is going to prevent me. I have the provision, every academic year I can update my syllabus content, I can modify, I can delete certain subject, I can introduce certain subject. This can be done. We have the provision of representing all these things in our the academic forum, academic council and senate. These are the things we have. But everything depends upon the person who is heading the quality of the teachers. So that is a very important role. Whatever the education system, we are going to make changes. The mindset of the teachers. If there is a willingness, there is a what is that? That fire is there within the faculty. He can do wonders. And okay, these are all going to come. But we are all not waiting for this kind of national education policy is going to come into picture. Okay, we can do some changes. As a, not for publicity, as a founder principal of the University Confucian College in a small village in Nimbeli, but the university has given the permission and within the system we played. We have done a societal transformation in that particular place.
Now it is going to be more autonomous. In future it is going to be more slowly the autonomous.
If it is going to be, the college is going to be more autonomous, they can do wonders.
They can decide themselves.
Even this is not going to happen, we can do wonders. There is a provision in there.
Professor Gopal.
Yeah. I will ask a question to the audience. Why do you think a syllabus is needed? What is the reason for a subject edukalam maths appadi solla maths is a nice topic Srinivas Ramanujam per sonnar Sathya so maths appadi or subject edukalam maths appadi nu poite irukalam what is the need for a syllabus edukaga irukonu so we are all trying to come up with that idea called stakeholders idile involve ana stakeholders ellame indha maadhiri agree pandranga In the mathematics 1, in engineering in undergrad, we had mathematics 1, mathematics 2, mathematics 3 because Usmania University never wanted any other name to be introduced. Maths is maths. You call it maths 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 semesters maths subject. But they don't use any other name. It is interoperable across the entire Usmania. Arts and Science College fellow knows it's a maths subject. Don't use any other term. To confuse everybody in the campus. It should be maths 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7. 7 semesters, 7 maths. In the maths, in the madhiri padu. See, institution is not in isolation. No man is an island. We don't want people to be islands also. No institution is an island. It cannot happen. Institution is something that is growing in a community. All community people should understand a similar language, a similar frequency. Then we thrive as a community. We progress as a community. So we need to keep the stakeholders in the mind. Therefore we say, this is what we are agreeing to. All of us agree to do maths like this in this semester, we do it. Everything is an ocean, every topic is an ocean, it's all lifelong learning. So within this framework, sir, chonnamadhi, system permit pannamadhi, this is all we can do. It is good to spell out in the beginning. This is what we will do in the next 6 months. It's always good. All stakeholders are party to it. Now the point here is that we will have omissions, commissions, students are students. We will have thrills, we will have spills. That is why we also be lively. Teachers also are lively. The same problem that fellow will say, oh sir, I forgot to do this sir. I dropped a jar of sulfuric acid, sir. It happens. There will be omissions, there will be commissions. That's the teaching learning environment. What is essential is, in spite of all this, we should be able to deliver that.
Thank you, Professor Gopal. I have one question to Sathya, being a financial man. How much money we are spending for the education? As for the first policy of 1968, they envisaged, Indira Gandhi time, they envisaged 6% of GDP is to be allotted for education. And in actually what has happened is, in 2008, 0.84% of GDP was spent on education in 2008. The same thing is, it is available in this Kasturirangan report. It has come down in 2014, 0.69. And now I think this research foundation, National Research Foundation, which they are going to institute there, they are going to annually pump in around 20,000 crores and it is going to be gradually increased over a period of 10 years. Now, how much money is going to be in the revised thing? how much money is likely to be spent on education, because the education is the least priority for anybody. Now I think this education policy is going to give a top priority for the country's education.
Okay, even now the 6% remains, the ambition of 6% remains, even in this government. But is it doable if you are going to ask me? At this juncture, it is not doable at 6%. Definitely, if you look at the figures, it's about 0.8% which we have. So, looking at the prospects, yes, it's an ambitious plan which they are putting in. For that, they have to fund it. If the priority is going to be in education, then it has to be seeded in. But however, if you look at it, it is the GDP of the central government budget. So we have to understand that. It's a central government budget, union budget. More money is also spent by state government also. Take for example Tamil Nadu. I have a complete status of Tamil Nadu profile of education, where they pump in. About 39,500 crores they spend in a year. And majority of the money goes for teacher salary. And teachers are working only for, I'm not against the teacher community. If you look at, they're just working for 160 days. I'm happy they're working for 160 days. But from the efficiency point of view, teaching has become a side business and other businesses have become major for them. And even though the spend is more, that it is going to the education fraternity only, but it is not boiling to the level of efficiency. Now, you may bring in a policy from Delhi. You can amend the Constitution of India for bringing all the changes. Whether the teaching community is inspired is the next question. So how do we do the capacity building is a big challenge. And I think for that, they should come and involve people who are on the ground level. And all this is fine. Liberal arts education, social and emotional learning. They're using the word called social and emotional learning. It's all fine. But how do we come to the last mile citizen who's there in Kannaki Nagar or Vyasarpadi or in the village in Madhurandagam or Chengalpet, who has no access to the basic facility where the capacity building has to happen. So it is good. The GDP 6% is must right now in India, but it's an ambition plan which the government has to relook at it and see how they can really make the teaching community accountable. There are good inspired teachers, but the teaching community has to be empowered. That is the first thing they should do. In Bhutan, teachers are paid more than the civil servants. Yeah, of course, India is a complex country. We cannot deny the fact, but we should bring in a system where how do we build the capacity. That requires a separate think tank and work by the government. It's a huge exercise. It's not easy. Yeah.
Thank you, Sathya. Anybody from the audience would like to seek clarifications or seek questions? You can come here.
I have a question.
Yes, you can. Can talk to the mic and introduce yourself, and then you can ask your question. Or one volunteer can take this mic to the audience.
Good morning and thank you for a very wonderful informative session. I must admit that I've not been through policy and the draft. It's what the bits and pieces of reviews on it that I've been through. You also mentioned about the teachers, the number of working days, their accountability, and from what we heard, this is a very ambitious plan. And the factors like accountability, the access, affordability, all these are very idealistic. And there is also mention about a B.Ed. course of a 4-year integrated program that prepares teachers to handle school children. Is there any plan to build the capacity of teachers at the collegiate level? If the plan is so ambitious, do we have the manpower or teachers who are capable of handling all this? And what are the plans towards that? Does the draft cater to the capacity building of teachers in the limited period of time? Especially that the ratio, the teacher-student ratio is a very idealistic one, 30:1. I know we have in classes of 70, and there are still students turned away without admissions. So how are you going to cater to that?
Adding to Madam's thing, even the contractual assignments also are going to be so. May I have the views of Professor Krishnamurti? Is it practically, how long it may take also?
Actually, recently we got a news, the statement from the university that certain places, the institutions are saying that we couldn't get qualified faculty. But the university developed their database, right? And who are all qualified to take up the teaching positions? The university has received a tremendous response. But we don't know why this kind of feedback is coming. When I go to some colleges for inspection in the rural places, and they are saying that we are not in the position. So this is some contradicting feedback we are getting. So I think I'm answering your question in the right sense. One side, the rural institution, they are telling that we couldn't get qualified faculty. When the other side, the university is asking the response from the community that who are all qualified to take up teaching position, the university has received lot of response.
Why there is a gap then?
That
or misconception
that,
or...
That should be, that there is a research question. And we have to really explore why that the available that much response is not going to rural, or that there is any local issues are there. This should be investigated. So this is the recent one, and we got this feedback from the university side, and the university itself, authorities itself taken up this task. Let us see that how the response.
Even sometime what happens when you go to the...
This is the one thing. Another thing is, let us look into the salary part. How much contract faculty is being paid, including our university council and college, is about 15,000 rupees. So how we can expect a quality teaching, a quality teacher? Even within this 15,000, we are in a position to get quality teachers. When we ask for the guest lecturer position for computer science, there are so many obligations. Surprised to know that even IIT graduates, they came for this position. So this is the thing. And how far we are really advertising that, how many people really looking, seeing that advertisement, whether the advertisement is very open or concealed, so many things we have to discuss under this topic. So I will not accept that the statement that we are not having qualified teachers. This is my personal perspective. One is, what is our willingness to pay for them?
Qualified teachers.
Yeah. If we put that, it is same thing if you put an advertisement in a different way. Okay, guest lecturer 50,000 instead of 15,000. You see the response. So where the point, the problem is, I am indirectly answering. So this is the reason for not having a qualified teacher.
In fact, some of the colleges, engineering colleges, when I go for giving a speech, I find that the persons who have completed engineering for the previous year, he is a lecturer and he is taking sessions for the third year BE students, and probably even without a post-graduation. That type of, they say that they are not getting a staff and all. Again, you know, there is a marked difference between the perception and what you say the reality. What is the India? You are as a
I think my observation from some of the Asian countries like Taiwan and America is that from the college perspective, most of the professors are into consulting. For example, look at Harvard. The reason why the students are innovative is very simple. The professor partners with the student on the venture. And second, is also contributing to some of the top corporate like Novo Nordisk and Johnson & Johnson, where they go and do some research for the company and give market research. I think first level, the government has to think, which I don't find anywhere in the national education policy. I'm in Delhi on July 10th. I'm representing on this matter from Swami Vivekananda School of Public Policy, where there is no interaction between the industry, academia and government. As simple as that. So we need to bring the interaction model to look at how do we first empower the faculty, point one. First, if you do that itself, remuneration will increase. Second, the corporates, where does our students go? They do go as an input to the corporates. Now, corporates are looking at a different model. What they are looking at is, okay, you develop the student the way you want, they will come and pick the best. The student has to have all the colleges to create. The corporates has to invest. Institution responsibility, IRs has to be brought in as a contribution. You have corporate social responsibility, right? The corporate social responsibility, you cannot attract to skill development. How many of them, I don't know about it, I don't know. For example, I am running a skill company. I cannot attract a corporate social responsibility to my company. It is not directly funded. You have to create a structure. It's complicated. By the time you achieve it, it will take 3 years, you will go bankrupt. Right? So, the institution has to come and partner with the colleges. It should become a mandate where they contribute a certain percentage. Then what happens? Then they have invested. Then they will take the professors to on board to interact. Third is remuneration point of view. Very simple. Today, IT, information technology in Chennai, most of these guys who are doing mechanical engineer, they forego mechanical engineering, go to software as a software engineer just because they pay more money. Simple. It attracts the best talent. Sundar Pichai is not core computer science engineer. He got attracted to the IT industry. The first attraction will come before the passion is the money. First you have to feed the hunger. Then comes the passion. So a teacher in India is expected to be poor. His students will become rich. Okay, I go to alumni meetings, I see the streets are poor. So the first lesson is the government has to really look at it as a remuneration point of view. It will only increase, the point comes where the GDP contribution increases. 6% if it goes, I'm sure the teachers will be the richest community. And when they're at comfort, they can invest on capacity building. I think this model has to evolve in the country. At this juncture, the National Education Policy 2019 doesn't talk about it at all. It is so much ambitious because it is drafted again from Delhi. It will have taken inputs from, of course, there are panel members from across India. I'm not denying that fact. But these problems have to be addressed. And how do we do it is the biggest challenge where the government has to look at as a policy. Yeah.
I do agree that we need different methodologies. We need to understand that there are factors which coercively are always good. Statistically, they always sound good. But when it comes to close at hand, we are having difficulties. How many people have studied Pythagoras theorem? All of us. Now, we want to find out whether somebody can tell me what is the approximate diagonal of this. Not many will be able to answer. The gap persists. All of us studied Pythagoras theorem. So the focus, which the report is silent, I agree, is ought to be on what is called problem solving. You are given a problem, if you can get all the ideas required to solve your problem, you have done the job. Now that becomes a practice school culture. Most of the times we expect things to happen in a practice school culture. I have this problem, I solved it, you give me 5 rupees, I am done. It doesn't help me. We have been emphasizing formal education so that the foundations are there until 8 years after the student leaves the institution. The institution should have 20 years of backing to remain tall for the student to come back. We want to build institutions which will remain like that. Oh, my college is 225 years old. Anyway, the point is we need alternative methods, whether it is contract, whether it is hourly basis, or what is the modus operandi, the institution is the best to decide. We will not be able to tell. Statistically, the fact is this.
When the focus is on problem solving, we'll become practice schools. When the focus is on teaching learning, we become more pedagogical.